I think the war in Ukraine was definitely a watershed moment for the crypto space in a lot of ways, right? Because the amount of funding that was sent to the both the Ukrainian government and to charities, supporting refugees and humanitarian causes, it was large. Like, these are more money than was provided by some fairly significant nation states. Whatever crypto was going to be, crypto was not going to be nothing.
So, Vitalik, in May 2021, you transferred some cryptocurrencies, collectively worth at the time more than $1 billion, to India's COVID crypto relief fund. And this donation demonstrates the interest of course, you, but other people also in the cryptocurrency world, to fund public goods in a completely new way. But we have been talking about public goods not just in disaster relief, but about infrastructure or the ecosystem branches, the safeguards, the critical infrastructure, gardening work, and so on, as public goods as well. So social technologies is public good. What was the future of the funding of public goods from your perspective?
I think that there are many futures of funding public goods, right? So I think the thing that's interesting about having these cryptocurrencies that have a large portion of their issuance going into public goods funding is that, like, you get to do it on a much larger scale, right? Mm-hmm. Because it's not just individuals that are sacrificing. Like, if there's a cryptocurrency where, ideally some percentage of the supply would just be in the hands of a charity at the beginning, like, there's no single person who has to sacrifice like $10 million mm-hmm. for that charity to get $10 million, right? Like, so, you don't have this kind of, one to N, tragedy of the commons where there's like one person who has to pay the entire cost, but the benefit is split among a huge number of people. And so no single person gets that much from their own one transaction, right? Basically what we have is you have through a cryptocurrency and a large number of people cooperating to turn that cryptocurrency and the associated community into something real. Through that process, you basically get this potentially pretty large amount of funds that can be transferred into some kind of charitable project, right? And I think taking that step of going beyond individuals and starting to think about institutions and structures that kind of are set up to structurally support charities, mm-hmm. In some ways, that's where large scale funding for public goods in the past has happened already, right? Either a large corporation or, in most cases, some kind of government that's been funding it. And so if, through crypto, we have other ways for communities to come together and kind of collectively create that value and send it to things that they all find valuable, that's something that could be very good, right? But that only solves one part of the problem, because with funding public goods, there isn't one public goods funding problem. There's two public goods funding problems. Mm-hmm. One of them is how to get the money, and the other is how do you actually decide where to send the money to, right? And this is always a challenge, because with markets for private goods, the funding mechanism has a choice mechanism built in, right? Because if you sell me, try to sell me apples, and someone else tries to sell me oranges, and I like apples, then I'm going to buy apples from you. I'm not going to buy oranges from the other person. And so if most people share my preference, then not only do the people who make apples actually get funded, but also the market gets the signal that apples are actually important and the thing that people really need right now, right? Mm-hmm. And now with charitable kind of nonprofit public good things in general, that kind of signal doesn't exist, right? And so the question is, what other kind mm-hmm. of signal does exist?
Yeah, so we will save the planet for future generations, but they don't yet vote.
Exactly, yes. Mm-hmm. Future generations is even the harder case, right? Mm-hmm. Because none of them are even alive yet. So mm-hmm. in some ways, there's no way to avoid people who live today making decisions on behalf of future mm-hmm. people. And how do you do that? Mm-hmm. So I think there's two like solutions that are, well, there's a few solutions, but two new ones that are interesting that people have been experimenting with in the crypto space. One of them is quadratic funding, right? Quadratic funding, it's this like matching mechanism where people can donate money to charities, and then the charities get an amount of money from a matching fund, where the amount of money that they get is based not just on how much people donated, but also on how many different people donated, right? So like if there's two projects where one of them gets $50 each from two people and the other gets $100 from 100 different people, then even though they both get $100, the second project actually gets a much higher level of matching, right? Because in some sense, like the second project is like a much more public good than the first project, because the first project, only two people have demonstrated that they actually care about it. Mm-hmm. In the second case, 100 people did, right? Mm-hmm. So it's basically using the donations themselves as a way of like measuring like to what extent do people care about some project and like what is the diversity of that caring. Mm-hmm. And if there is a project that people from like very diverse and large groups of people care about, then that project gets wider support, right?
So this is sorry to interrupt, but so there's an element of democracy in here, in the sense that it's not exactly one person, one vote, but each donation counts as one vote-ish to this funding as a matching partner. Now, of course, you've been a matching partner to quadratic funding efforts. So why would you choose quadratic funding as a matching fund provider, where you can simply provide your matching fund like one-on-one, or providing your matching fund in the usual crowdfunding way, in which your $1 donated counts as two or things like that, which would be much simpler to operate? So from a perspective of someone who provides the matching fund to maximize the public good of the ecosystem, what's the thought behind making this choice?
Sure. So I think probably the biggest reason why it might be a good idea for a matcher to match quadratically is because the quadratic mechanism, it does this good job of not just encouraging more donations, which is what matching is normally for, but also like actually extracting this information from the public about like what kinds of things in the ecosystem actually are useful to people, right? Mm-hmm. Like, because especially if you're trying to help an ecosystem where the distance between you and that ecosystem is larger, mm-hmm. and so you don't have a lot of on the ground knowledge about which specific project is good, mm-hmm. but the people in that community do. Mm-hmm. Then by sending your money to this matching pool, you're basically empowering that group. And you're basically telling them that, you know, look, like I'm going to actually trust your judgments about which projects actually deserve donations. And I'm going to basically make my own donations be based on that, right? So I think that's kind of the idea behind matching in general. The quadratic formula, I think, you know, there are some very like mathematical ways to describe why the quadratic formula is theoretically optimal. But I think the kind of easiest layman explanation is that it does a good job of balancing between the need to be democratic and the need to favor things that have a very wide and kind of diverse base of support. Mm-hmm. Because projects that have a diverse base of support have a harder time just gathering together that support by themselves. They have like the bigger the community, the larger the tragedy of the commons can be. And also the balancing between that and the other issue, which is the fact that like different people do have different levels to which they care about different things, right? Mm-hmm. And there are going to be cases where like there's one thing that benefits 100 people, another thing that benefits 200 people, but you actually want to support the first thing because the first thing is much more of a benefit for them, right? Mm-hmm. So in some ways it's like trying to avoid both tyranny of the minority and tyranny of the majority. Mm-hmm. you know, there's like this argument, you know, which, I mean, as I said, you know, you can explain it with math, and I even have a blog post that explains it with math, and Glenn has a paper, but the idea is that it tries to like really balance between those two effects.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so basically it's kind of as a matcher, you're pre-committing to trust the collective intelligence, for lack of a better term, in a way that try to get maximal input from each individual, but also from their community as well, into this question, like what is actually good for the community as a whole. And so, sorry for interrupting you. You were going to explain the other innovation.
Yes. So the other one is retroactive public goods funding. Mm-hmm. So retroactive public goods funding is a kind of interesting and different idea, right? And it doesn't have to be an alternative to quadratic funding. Like you actually could use quadratic funding retroactively. But the core idea is instead of allocating money to projects based on what you expect they're going to be able to do, you allocate money to projects or teams based on what they already have done, right?
Like an award.
So, exactly, yeah. Mm-hmm. Instead of you know, a grant, it's an award or a prize. Mm-hmm. And the idea behind retro funding is basically that it's much easier to get like good collective agreements on what actually was good led to successes than it is to get a collective agreement on what kinds of things are going to lead to successes, right? Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, collective agreements can sometimes fail at like even agreeing on, you know, what was good or bad 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. But like, it's an easier problem than the problem of figuring out or trying to figure out what's going to be good in the future. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the guiding ideas here is that like there needs to be room for people who have you know, very good ideas and who have like some unique ability to predict, you know, what actually is going to make sense, and to be able to make bets on that, you know, even if those bets are just not going to become consensus until the thing is has already happened, right? Mm-hmm. So the idea is with retro funding is that like ideally we don't just want you know, individuals like basically just working for free and then hoping that they get a retro reward at the end. Ideally, we would even want an ecosystem where, you know, people would even be able be willing to invest in projects. Based on the hope that they might get some kind of retro reward at the end, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So basically trying to kind of separate out the function of trying to like predict what approach will lead to a good outcome from the problem of trying to figure out what kind of outcomes actually were good, which, you know, you still can do with quadratic votes or any other kind of vote that you want.
Yeah, here in Taiwan, we're in the C-Lab and the Taiwan Contemporary Culture Lab. And one of the labs is the Social Innovation Lab. And the same idea is more well known as the social impact bond in which the people pay for success, or the to be more specific, governments pay for success, but in 2030 or something. And then the impact investors, because they got this promise from the government to pay in 2030 if the project has worked somehow, to the degree that the project has worked by that time. So they will be much more interested in taking impact investments to such social entrepreneurs and provide them the funding that they need for the next 8 years, to be precise. Now, but that's because the government can issue bonds and lead to a kind of legitimate quantification, regardless of who is in charge of the national government here in 2030, they will probably honor whatever bonds that they have promised back in 2022. But in Ethereum, of course, it's based on smart contracts, or is it something that's a kind of code enforced legitimacy? How would you enforce this kind of pre-commitment to social impact bonds across many years?
Yeah, so I think with crypto, what you ideally want to be doing is like same as what I said with charities, right? You want to try to move beyond individuals doing this and get to the point where you have institutions doing this, right? Mm-hmm. Because you know, institutions are much more long-term robust and scalable. Mm-hmm. So the idea here would be like if you have some major crypto project mm-hmm. That actually like includes a mechanism as part of the DAO. That chooses which projects to give retro rewards to, and you make the governance of that robust enough, mm-hmm. and that project becomes successful enough that people are confident that mm-hmm. it will keep getting revenue for a long time in the future. Mm-hmm. Then that would be one way that it could happen, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. I think.
Yeah, so the social entrepreneur in this case would not just be one or two individuals. Each entrepreneur, each co-founder is actually a large, well-established charity institution or co-op or something. Is that the idea? So that by itself, it will last longer and people can see that they will be around with the kind of continuous funding as provided by the pay for success theme, or am I hearing you incorrectly?
I think it depends what you mean by entrepreneur. Like, I think maybe social investor would be the better term here, right? Because, So the entities that are providing the, mm-hmm. the money at the end mm-hmm. would be like basically hopefully crypto projects and DAOs and like mm-hmm. similar kinds of things. The mm-hmm. people who are kind of the founders who actually do the projects, they mm-hmm. would just be individuals.
Okay.
And then you could have investors kind of like basically participating in these projects by donating money to them pretty early. And that would be one way in which they kind of take some risk off of the people working on them, but they would also get some share of the reward.
I see. So basically it's the same as the quadratic funding with the three parties, but with the added kind of institutional norm that the people who are going to provide the fund at the end will not as an individual go bankrupt or just withdraw the wallet or something disappear before the final funding is delivered. Is that the idea?
Right. So I think the similarities are, right, like in both mm-hmm. cases, you want to have some kind of institution mm-hmm. In this case, that institution could be a DAO, it could be a cryptocurrency that has some coin supply, it could be a project. And that institution makes this like commitments to keep putting money into the mechanism for a long time. And like if there are some governance components, it would also commit to like operating those governance components fairly, right? So that would be, that's like the part that you can't ensure with code, but like, you know, you have to ensure with norms, with culture and with people, no matter what you do. So that's one part of the players. Another, then in quadratic funding, the other two participants, one is people who donate and the other is people who make projects. Mm-hmm. And then in retroactive funding, the other two participants would be people who make projects and potentially people who invest in mm-hmm. projects. Mm-hmm. And people who make projects and people who invest in projects could end up later getting paid out of the retro fund.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. So that's very clear that there's structural similarities between the two inventions that you just mentioned. So because we talk about risk-taking entities and you just declared publicly that you're becoming a risk-taking entity, and I quote, to be more risk-taking and less neutral in your interview with Time Magazine in March this year as a public figure, right? So you also tweeted in February that Ethereum, the technology that you co-founded, is neutral, but you as an individual are not neutral. So what does neutrality mean to you in these public statements? Is it across different dollars, different coins, different people, different countries, different social groups, or what?
I think, neutrality for Ethereum is, for example, I think definitely, I think neutrality between countries, definitely neutrality between many different kinds of social groups. there are kinds of neutrality that I think blockchains just can't achieve, right? So like, for example, like Bitcoin does not achieve neutrality between, you know, people who lived before 2012 and people who lived after 2012, mm-hmm. because people who lived before 2012 already got half of, mined half of all the Bitcoins, mm-hmm. right? So there definitely are limits to the extent to which blockchains can actually be neutral, especially once you start thinking about the financial side. Mm-hmm. But on the side of like just being platforms where people can build and do applications, I think the blockchain layer definitely does like strive to be as neutral between like different people and different uses as possible. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing that is not neutral, and I think doesn't have to be and even can't be neutral, is of course the community, right? Like communities that create blockchains, like I think they do believe in the idea of like creating these decentralized neutral platforms, but inevitably they also do have like specific ideas about what kinds of things are wrong in the world that could be better in the world if these kinds of platforms existed. And I think like especially this relates to how we talked about the importance of avoiding setting bad examples and making sure to set good examples. For example, there are things that the community can do and that the community, I think, should do to try to like even actively encourage the uses of the technology that they want to see more of. And like in that case, I do think that there is some level of neutrality that they should strive for. So like, for example, I think like I've talked a lot about how I think many parts of the crypto space are too US focused, and like I would want them to be more geographically diverse and more inclusive toward people in Latin America, people in Asia, people in Eastern Europe or Africa or wherever else. And I've even tried to kind of support and interact with all of these communities myself. So like that is I think an example of a kind of neutrality that even the Ethereum community tries to go for, that like most Web2 projects don't really even think about. But there are other ways in which the community is not neutral, right? Like the Ethereum community in general, I think is not neutral, for example, between people just trying to save their own money and dictators, mm-hmm. for example, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that there's lots of different examples of that. And I think like some level of the community kind of acting to support its own values is healthy.
So from the sounds of it, it sounds like that you're not neutral when it comes to closing off future possibilities in a sense of a dictator that would be just robbing people of alternative choices, in a sense of a large scale failure of cybersecurity or whatever, then that will mean that you have to literally fork the community and so on, right? So basically, there's a strong norm that says we need to not exclude newcomers to the ecosystem, that we need to empower people that we have not met yet, including from the cultures that we have not met yet, or from speaking languages that we do not know yet, and so on. Where do you see that coming from? Do you see that it's a kind of natural consequence of being born in the internet culture, in the open source and software freedom culture, or do you trace it to other roots?
Mm. I think as far as my own influences, I kind of internet freedom culture and open source software culture are definitely really high up there. Mm-hmm. In some ways, I've even described blockchains as being a kind of like the way to adapt the ideals of open source software to the 21st century, right? So that, instead of just the software being free, which doesn't really mean that much if the version of the software that most people use is still like relies on communicating through a central server where all the data is owned and all the connections are controlled by one company. Mm-hmm. But not just having the software be free, but also having the state and the its entire application be open and not dependent on a single company. So, I think that there's definitely a lot of inspiration from open source ideas in there. I think there's definitely inspiration from kind of earlier pre-Ethereum and even pre-Bitcoin kind of cryptocurrency ideas, and like basically asking a different question, but still the important one of like, what are the virtues of the internet, and how do we try to extend those virtues so that they also apply to money, which is something that historically I think has been like it. But before cryptocurrency, it did maintain this kind of very strong tie to legacy institutions that most of the other applications existing on the internet did not.
But this reminds me that I read that you have once said, and I quote, my life is to become a bridge of everything, end of quote. And to me, you describe two very different worlds, one of institutions that provides essential financial services and provides a reliable, if a little bit slow at times, service to people who need to basically make their ends meet, and another world of abundance of software freedom, open access, and things like that, with a decentralized culture, but before cryptocurrencies did not really touch anything of the financial system, but you have bridged the two. But that's not the bridge of everything, it's a bridge of two worlds. So what do you mean by a bridge of everything?
I mean, I think it hasn't really been a conscious choice for me, right? Like, I don't think I even started out in 2013 kind of wanting to become a bridge between things. I think what happened was that I had just went out on this long journey, just trying to explore and understand. At the time, the world's Bitcoin community, right? So I went to see the libertarian Bitcoin community in New Hampshire, then the left-leaning anarchist community in Catalonia and Spain, then the less kind of non-ideological pragmatists, in Switzerland, the community is in Austria, Slovakia, later Israel. And this was just part of a curiosity. I just wanted to learn and see, what are all of these Bitcoin communities about? And then Ethereum started. And after Ethereum, I had gotten used to the lifestyle of basically not having a base and always being willing to travel to places. And we got invitations to all kinds of conferences. And so because I felt basically no opportunity cost and to being in one place instead of another place, I would be the one to actually, go and accept all of these invitations. And so I'd end up, jumping between all of these different continents. I would end up jumping between different kinds of crypto communities, talking to Bitcoin people, talking to the academics, talking to business people, later on talking to government people. And it's this interesting position that I've ended up falling into, where I end up being in the middle of all of these groups, many of which are actually very different from each other, right? I guess challenges that I've set to myself is to basically the question of how can you take that position and use that as an opportunity and actually try to bring people together and create solutions that satisfy all of them.
Yeah, in 2005, 2006, I used to do that myself when doing nowadays Raku, back then Pro 6, trying to work with all the different language communities and programming languages, but also spoken languages. And during those 2 years, I called it Erdursing, after Paul Erdős, who did something like that across the branches, bridging the branches of mathematics. So I definitely relate to that, the physical journey, but also the learning journey. And according to what I have read, your father said that you wrote as part of your learning journey pretty early on, called the Encyclopedia of Bunnies at the age of 7. And I quote, basically, he came up with this whole universe that is populated by bunnies, but it's all governed by very strict formulas, end of quote. That is very innovative. Do you remember how you came up with this idea?
I think I remember writing it. I'm trying to remember what I was thinking when I was doing that.
What was this formula?
I think, formulas. I mean, what were the formulas about? There were like formulas for the population of bunnies. There are formulas for like how fast bunnies can go over time and what their acceleration is. All of these different things. I think this was just, the 7-year-old version of myself trying to create this kind of weird fantasy science fiction world that's just really cool. I don't know. I don't think I was thinking much.
Sounds like the kind of standard model for bunnies. So over the course of your learning tour, which is not fixed in any time zone, as we just talked about, what and who have influenced you the most? Like, who do you have in mind, or what do you have in mind, or what cultures or experience have you in mind?
Part of it is definitely, my family and school and everything in Canada growing up. Since then, I think a lot of it has definitely been different kinds of internet communities. The Bitcoin community that I was in and joined back in 2011. I don't want to say I was in the Bitcoin community until I started Ethereum, because I think in reality, the Ethereum community, it basically is what was before part of the Bitcoin community, right? I think first there was a crypto community that cared about just Bitcoin, and then there's a crypto community where there's part of it that cares just about Bitcoin, and part of it cares about other different things. So I feel like I've been sort of, in some ways, part of the same community all along, though it's definitely slowly changed in different ways over time. Things outside of the crypto space, the open source world, the rationalist community is like one that I've learned a lot from. I think both helped me understand many aspects of how the world works, and even how things like disagreements and human conflict work, and certain kinds of traps that it's very easy to fall into. Definitely end up learning a lot from them. Economists in general, and also academics in cryptography, right? Like, I have called the space crypto economics, and I think both the crypto and the economics are absolutely crucial parts to that. Yeah. And I think over the last couple of years, we've also been realizing that, like, there's also a third pillar, this kind of not just economic social science, that's also very important to how these crypto blockchain platforms work as well. I feel like I've been spending time just reading things that people in all of these different communities write almost from the beginning. Like, I remember even when I was in high school, I would often read books by like libertarians, and then read some books by left-leaning people, and it would be interesting to see the contrast between the two different perspectives, coming to my own opinions about what issues which of those groups is more or less correct about. Going beyond that, I think it's this big long list and combination of things, and then obviously all of the people that I've met and interacted with, and all of the places that I visited in person.
Well, in past years, you've been to Taiwan several times to participate in forums, not just on fintech and cryptocurrencies, but on just imagination of possible societies. And in Taiwan, of course, we have a lot of influences from the kind of cultures that you have just outlined, and we trace our ideological and cultural and religious, also spiritual roots to many, many different civilizations. So what do you think of Taiwan, of the local developer scenes, of the people you have encountered, the ways that we have been interacting with you, and so on?
Definitely very impressed by many kinds of things and many communities in Taiwan. I've always appreciated in the local developer scene just people's ability to, like, people's excitements to learn, and people's willingness to self-organize. Like, there's just people who independently decides to go and form study clubs about various kinds of topics, and learn about Ethereum, learn about zero knowledge proofs, learn about everything. Mm-hmm. And I've always found that very amazing. Seeing all of the people working on many different kinds of things, like there's projects to deal with climate change. There have been various kinds of financial projects. There's people trying to use these digital democracy mechanisms. There's people working on privacy preserving technology, mm-hmm. And all kinds of things. So I think definitely very impressed on the developer side, impressed by kind of many other more subtle aspects of the culture as well, like how Taiwan doesn't feel like it tries very hard to be impressive. It just mm-hmm. kind of tries to be itself. Yep. And I think there's something very beautiful about that. Mm-hmm. I think, it is impressive, I'm definitely looking forward to coming back.
Mm-hmm. And you're most welcome. Many people in Taiwan, after they learned about both retroactive public funding and quadratic funding, end up starting small experiments. But they also tell me that it's easy to implement pay for success, right? Social impact bond as a private entity or a small institution, even if you don't set the terms too long, like if it's just retroactively after a couple months or after a year, we can probably mm-hmm. do it quite easily. But when they implement quadratic funding, they run into some very practical difficulties. Unlike quadratic voting, where we can authenticate individual person, allocate them 99 points, which we did quite successfully in the presidential hackathon, there's a real incentive in quadratic funding for someone to pretend to be many people. Because if you pretend to be 5,000 people, then you count as 5,000 votes. And so your input to the matcher, basically you can just tell the matcher that I have the support of 5,000 people, where of course these are just fake wallets and so on. Now, encountering spam, encountering fake accounts and so on, there are what we call heuristics, like some rules that we can approach and so on to try to suss out this kind of fake accounts and so on. But it takes resource and therefore harder to implement than retroactive public good funding. What do you think about these practicalities?
I think it's definitely a real problem. But I do think that ultimately a lot of these applications inside of the crypto space are going to need to have some way of authenticating not just resources but also individual people. Mm-hmm. That doesn't have to involve some centralized authority like mm-hmm. signing off on people's passports or whatever. Mm-hmm. Right, like there is something like the proof of humanity protocol, where the way that works is basically people upload a video of themselves and then they can generate a profile, and if anyone sees that some video doesn't actually contain a person, or that two different videos that have been submitted contain the same person, then they can send each transaction with a deposit to challenge that, and the DAO basically has a vote to determine whether or not the challenge is legitimate, right? So the goal of this project, Proof of Humanity, is to basically create an attestation authenticates the fact that this Ethereum address actually corresponds to a particular unique person. Mm-hmm. And that's something that can be used as a primitive in regular voting, quadratic funding. Mm-hmm. I think Gitcoin might actually be taking into account proof of humanity attestations already. And I think with those kinds of systems, it might actually be possible to create these governance mechanisms that aren't just limited to what you can do with purely financial mechanisms.
Mm-hmm. So just to basically reiterate what I have just heard, through proof of humanity, anyone can kind of authenticate a Ethereum address just by recording themselves talking to the screen, to the camera, and have other already vetted in humans to introduce them into the proof of humanity world. So if I want to create 5,000 fake accounts, I'll have to convince 5,000 people, I guess, to each record something into the camera. Did I get that right?
Yes.
Okay. Assume that this works and we can bootstrap quadratic funding, and not many people will recruit 5,000 people to the proof of humanity system. I know that you've been working on something called a soul-bound token, or the SBT. How is that different from a proof of humanity authenticated wallet holding NFTs and coins and so on?
Sure. So the idea of like soulbound tokens in general is basically these attestations that are non-transferable, right? So they prove something about you, and ideally they cannot be traded. Like you cannot sell them, you cannot give them to someone else. Like they're just bound to whoever actually received them, right? So like one simple example of this is, you know, if you want to, let's say, create a digital like chat room that's like a club for everyone who climbed Mount Everest, then like you would want to verify that whoever is coming in actually is someone who climbed Mount Everest and didn't just like buy a token off of someone who just professionally climbs Mount Everest thousands of times and then, you know, sells proofs of that to the highest bidder, right? So like that would be an example of something that you would want to like create some kind of attestation for, and then actually make that soul bound, so make it non-transferable. So I had a post on my blog that's just called a soul bound, where I talk about some possible technological means to make that happen. Like basically the idea is that in principle, it's always possible to like give someone your key and try to like trade anything that you have digitally away. But what you can do is you can make trades unenforceable, right? You can make a mechanism where even if you give a token away, there's some rule that says that like if you prove that you are you, then you can actually go and basically claim it back, right? And if that kind of mechanism exists, then well, no one would actually be willing to buy it from you. So proof of humanity attestations, I think, are actually an example of a soulbound token, right? Because like we don't want people to be able to like sell their human proof of human verified identities to someone else and allow one person to be able to pretend to be 5,000 different people, right? Like we want it so that if there are these 5,000 different tokens, they actually are under the like long-term control of 5,000 different and independent people. So I think this kind of technology, like it can be used for a lot of things. And I think that it is a key to opening up the space of applications to beyond like just financial, right? Like I also wrote another post about last year where I basically tried to argue the case that like the definition of financial is mechanisms that don't try to prevent like selling or collusion or a kind of undesired coordination, right? And there's some good economic reasons why there are limits to like what kinds of things you can actually accomplish with financial mechanisms. And if you want to try to accomplish more than that, then like you do need to be able to prevent people from trading things, right? I think people are familiar with that idea in the context of voting. Like the reason why we have secret ballots is that we don't want it to be possible for people to credibly sell their vote to someone else. And democracy really relies on that to be able to function, right? But I think, you know, there's other uses of this, like proof of humanity attestations being soulbound is good. Another one that I care about is this learn to earn concept. Basically, the idea here is like if you have a DAO or like some project and you're launching a new token, and let's say you want to distribute that token to your users, but you don't want to just do an airdrop like Uniswap did, because you know, these days airdrops, like you're going to give them to people who care about your project, but you're also going to give them to lots of people who don't care about your project, and they'll just start selling, and like you've just like drop the price of your token by a lot with for no actual gain, right? And so what if instead you can say, if someone can prove that they have done some exercise where they learned something about how, say, the Uniswap protocol or some other protocol works, and actually took some actions inside of the system, actually participated inside of the system, even like did some small like initial tasks to help the DAO, then like they could get an attestation and then they could get a reward of some kind, right? And if he wants to like actually make sure, exactly. And if you want to ensure that you're actually incentivizing like widespread participation instead of incentivizing, you know, 15 people in a computer farm just like participating over and over 24/7 and then selling receipts to other people, which, you know, actually happens in plenty of online games, then, like, you know, you want some kind of soulbound thing.
Yeah, so I think this is basically trying to formulate proof of participation as something that's different from just mere engagement in the sense of just clicking something. And it's important, of course, on the voting case. I remember learning from Estonia that while they can do electronic voting over the distance, of course, as you mentioned, there's always this coercion kind of scenario where someone just forcibly take the card and the key and maybe the password and whatever security guards, because nobody else is watching, to ensure that it's actually secret ballot. So they develop a system where you can always show up and revoke basically your e-vote. And that is something that I think is quite important, that it will make it not pay to force someone to hand you the password to your soulbound wallet, because you can always somehow take it back through some community verified means. So I think that's going to be quite important. And I mentioned the number 5,000 because that's the threshold in Taiwan's digital democracy platform, join.gov.tw, to demand a ministerial response. Is the threshold of participation in order to get a collaborative meeting, for example, with the ministries. So if anyone can fake 5,000 identities, then the ministries will be very busy. And the current way we do that is through SMS authentication. So you have to have a locally registered telephone number. So it's not your real name or identity or anything like that, but you have to prove that you hold a working SMS-enabled number within the local telecommunication. Now, that is quite inclusive in the sense that migrant workers and so on can easily get the prepaid cards and so on required to this kind of authentication. But for people who say, why would we need something that works internationally? Why wouldn't we just all use not government but telecommunication carriers verified KYC enabled identities? It could be a passport or something that is verified by the telecommunication carrier. What advantage does the soulbound token protocols hold over these centralized institutions that's not government?
Yeah, and I think one issue with these centralized mechanisms is like they haven't really been tested under very high pressure, right? Like if you actually put like basically $1 billion bounty on creating 10,000 fake identities, then you know, are there people who are going to actually be able to create fake identities? Like, you know, even in the US, the telecom companies get hacked all the time, right? Like there's this kind of epidemic of SIM swapping attacks that keeps happening. And as a result of, you know, there's even an active movement of trying to move away from SMS for authentication in a lot of cases. So I think limits to security, and it's these kinds of limits to security where, like, it's secure, it looks secure up until something really bad happens, and then suddenly it's, like, insecure for everyone. Like, trying to avoid those situations, I think, is one argument for having something that's like more decentralized and more transparent. Sometimes you don't even try the you don't even trust the institution, right? So like, for example, if you're just doing something to like say allocate Taiwan's government money and you have the Taiwan government issuing identities, then you could argue, well, there isn't any actual trust issue because like people have to trust the Taiwan government to actually provide the money anyway. If you try to, you know, go a step higher and say, you know, you want to make a global UBI coin, for example, or even to go back to a previous example, let's say the way that try to make this kind of Twitter as a global public square, is to create a platform where mm-hmm. like every user can vote, and the users have to be authenticated as people somehow. Then like, what happens if North Korea tries to print 50 million fake people that are all under the government's control, mm-hmm. right? So I think, you know, especially once the kind of trust circle goes larger than any of your institutions, mm-hmm. Then you have to look at decentralized approaches at some point. Mm-hmm. But I also think that, like, it's good to try lots of these different things. And I think the more forms of authentication we can try and combine with each other, the better. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the idea here is that so in the future, if instead of just presenting a local SMS, which as you mentioned, people are moving away from that as a second factor in multi-factor authentications, people would prove what? That some community somewhere in the world recognize them as a human born in that community? Would it be decentralized so that any jurisdictions, even the jurisdictions not currently linked to the international system, can nevertheless bring people in? Or what does global mean exactly?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's always a trade-off between security and inclusiveness, mm-hmm. right? And I think the benefit of more decentralized approaches where, and like especially where you try to not just recognize governments, but also recognize other forms of trust, mm-hmm. Is that you might be able to like actually get more of both at the same time, right? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, on the one hand, as I mentioned, like North Korea can print 50 million fake passports of themselves mm-hmm. if they want to.
Yep.
And like, you don't want that to turn into, 50 million votes on like some kind of global decentralized Twitter. But, and on the other hand, there are people being born even today whose existence kind of isn't recognized in any kind of official documents, right? But on the other hand, it is well known in like some kind of local community. So, you know, is it going to involve some combination of like official ideas and some form of web of trust? I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I do think that we need to like start looking at different combinations of these ideas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm really happy to work with you in the upcoming future to make that a shared reality. So thank you for sharing your time with us, with TaiwanPlus. And because it's not just a show about social innovation and open government, but also about youth participation. So my last question is that, do you have any advice for the younger generations, people who are born into a world already with cryptocurrencies, already with the Ethereum community? Do you have any advice or words for them?
Sure. I think the best way to learn and the best way to get into the community is to just start doing. Mm-hmm. I think people should find some community that does something that interests them personally. And the best way to really learn and get in is to just actively start contributing and participating and see where it takes you. I think that is the way that I personally got into the Bitcoin community, right? Like I was looking for people was looking for some way to earn Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. And I eventually found someone willing to pay me 5 Bitcoins per article to write articles on this blog. And like back then, 5 Bitcoins was only $4. Mm-hmm. But you know, that ended up being the start of a long journey. Mm-hmm. So I think in general, like you don't want to learn passively, right? Because mm-hmm. if you learn passively, it's easy to feel like you're learning things, but actually like there's a limit to how much you can learn passively. And there's a limit, and like learning passively can't actually kind of help you really participate in and understand the community. Like you do have to, I think at some point, start like actually going out there and doing things. And once you do, I think, these days, the communities are more open and welcoming than ever. I expect you're going to have a good time.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. such advice from the original Learn to Earn participants. So thank you for joining today, and please check more videos and information on TaiwanPlus.com. Also, we have a YouTube channel. If you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. And thank you, Vitalik, again. See you next time. Live long and prosper.
Thank you too, Audrey. Live long and prosper.